I like peanut butter. I like peanut butter. Peanut butter. I like peanut butter. I like peanut butter. I like peanut butter.
You're listening to the Cheap Geek Podcast.
I like peanut butter.
Today's podcast is brought to you by Audible. Get a free audiobook download and 30-day free trial at audibletrial.com/CheapGeek. We're back. Welcome back to the Cheap Geek Podcast. This is episode number 64.
You can't fake this level of stupid. Or can you?
And we're back, and it begins again. So thank you very much for tuning in to the Cheap Geek Podcast, episode number 64. And we got a lot of stuff to talk about, as we normally do. If you're listening to us on YouTube, thank you very much. If you're listening to us on iTunes, thank you very much. If you're listening to us on whatever.
Google Play,
thank you very much. If you listen to us on SoundCloud, thank you very much.
Spotify,
thank you very much. What else?
iHeartRadio,
thank you very much.
A bunch of places,
thank you very much. So we have lots of stuff to talk about. This is a podcast where we talk about things to be interesting, and we hope that you do too.
Yeah.
So very nice. So if you're listening for the very first time, you can always give us a call if you'd like, and you can give us a call and leave little comments, questions, concerns, things you'd like us to talk about on a podcast. And that phone number is
575-208-4025.
That's right. And you can also find us at cheapgeekpodcast.libsyn.com, because Libsyn does our providing for our podcast.
Ew.
Very nice. You can also find us on cheapgeek.net. There's a link for the podcast. You can click us there. You can go to the Facebook group. Just search for Cheap Geek.
Yeah.
We're there. You can go to the Facebook group for Cheap Geek Podcast. We're also there. You can find us on Instagram, Twitter, YouTube, and most everywhere fine quality podcasts are being served.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's true. Now, after such a stellar introduction, we must get to the first topic that you have written out for us today, because this is evidently becoming a thing, and it just amazes me at how stupid some people are.
This all started,
hold on, and yeah. By some people, I'm talking about the people who are actually reading this article, not the people that are doing the things in the article.
Yeah, and this all started because earlier this week, I read an article about the topic. And the article had some very stunning facts and figures in it.
Yeah.
I couldn't believe that it was actually true. But in this particular article, doctors are genuinely concerned about the online laundry detergent pod memes.
What is that meme?
That meme that basically encourages people to eat laundry detergent pods.
So the laundry pod challenge is what they were calling it, right?
Yes.
Yeah, I seen this and was like, what are these people, okay.
And what's sad is, like, this article's from earlier this week, and it actually had to be updated twice over the course of this week.
Yes.
Now, it starts off with featuring a couple of memes that you've seen on Instagram regarding, you know, taking a bite out of a laundry pod. And it's weird, because I actually didn't see a lot of these memes at first.
Yeah.
The one I did see was, rubs a magic lantern and a genie comes out. You have one wish. I'd like to eat a laundry pod.
Yeah.
Genie slaps me, you know? And that was the only one I'd seen. Oh, and then the Can You Cook? Boys Who Can Cook did one where it was laundry pods and, like, milk.
See?
Yeah.
This whole thing is a joke. And it started out as a joke. And we got this article that showed up, an actual... From Arizona, okay.
Yes, from Phoenix.
Yeah. and they're like, doctors are warning kids, like, don't eat them. Stop biting the laundry pod things.
Yes.
And it's like, okay. it's a joke.
It's a joke. But this article did mention that in 2017 alone, the Arizona Poison and Drug Information Center and affiliated said there were 239 reported laundry pod exposures across the state. So in the state of Arizona alone, there were 239 reported laundry pod exposures.
Okay. What's going on in Arizona?
Are the kids
there really that dumb?
I can say the Southwest has some brightly colored and fancy candies. But there is no way, even if you put a laundry pod towards your face, that you can think it's candy. It smells clearly like Gain or Tide or whatever.
Well, speaking of Tide, right?
Yeah.
A spokesperson for Procter & Gamble, the maker of Tide, told the channel, ABC 15 in Phoenix.
Yeah.
Right? They said the company implemented child-resistant packaging for its pods and is working with partners to educate parents on properly storing the containers. So they're treating it like little kids.
Yeah.
Are eating it, right? So when they asked them about the social media jokes and memes, the company said, we've seen no indication of an increase of cases seeking medical treatment amongst infants and teenagers associated with the recent uptick in social media conversation or in our consumer calls.
Oh, God. This is so
sad. And then they had to put the disclaimer on there. Our laundry packs are in highly concentrated detergent meant to clean clothes, blah, 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 blah. In other words, Tide's like, no. When Arizona 15, boy, they're like, oh, no, this is we got 1,500 cases or whatever it is. And,
yeah.
But Tide, the company, is like, no.
No. And that's funny because I couldn't, at the time I read this article earlier this week, I couldn't find a nationwide statistic.
And there's really not so much, but in 2017, Arizona Poison and Drug Information Center.
239.
Yeah, yeah. Laundry pod exposures across the state. That's not people biting into them or eating them or chewing them. It's just saying exposure.
Which, I have been guilty of it because I did squeeze one and it got me in the face. So I'm stupid.
Well, no, but I mean, that's not you eating it.
But that is an exposure.
I think that the story that Arizona 15 ran was to try to, basically it was, they tried to really drum it up as being something like, oh my God, your kids are eating laundry pods, like to really sort of inflame the issue when really there's nothing to be inflamed upon.
But
it's social media meme. Old people got caught off guard. The adults are like, what? Kids are eating laundry pods. Oh, no.
But
that reminds me of another meme I've seen where somebody was like, hey, everybody, check your bananas. I found an AK-47 in my banana. You know what I mean? So it's kind of like, okay, this shit is a joke.
Yeah.
And it's not, you know, and so I think they're blowing it up, trying to make it into something.
But the problem is it has turned into something due to the uproar and response to this article. This article, which was featured in Arizona, ended up making it all the way to the East Coast, made it to California, and it ended up on national news. So, and as a result, many national news outlets talked about it. The response from that is that everybody is now making more memes and people are actually trying to eat them.
Here we go. And like even in the UK, right? The mirror.co.uk, they ran an article too. It said teens begged to stop eating washing tablets and dangerous new craze.
Really?
Well, it wasn't a freaking craze until knuckleheads in Arizona and probably other places ran these stories. Like, oh my God, we got to run the story. We're going to do people a service. And hopefully we'll trend on Twitter.
Yeah, because it's all
and the
about
article
that,
goes like
that
this.
Twitter.
The article in the UK basically says, teenagers are eating detergent pods. The online trend is worrying doctors and parents. And then they have a link for some videos.
Look at that caption. Not orange flavor.
It's and it says the craze began last year when a student filmed herself munching on Tide Pods.
Really?
To most, the whole thing is a joke, but some bolder teens have gone so far as to tuck in. That means, like, go all in.
Mm-hmm.
So over the last month, the Tide Pod Challenge has taken off, and teens are seen popping them in their mouths, eating the liquid, and even cooking with the tablets. Oh, my God, they're cooking Tide. It's a freaking, gel, but not jelly.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
And you know what? They're trying to link this to something from The Onion back in 2015 where a joke editorial was written.
Yeah.
From the perspective of a child who wanted nothing more than to eat a blue and red detergent pod.
See?
Little did the satirical site know that it was truly being prophetic at the time. And now the Mirror actually has statistics.
Yeah, they are making this shit up.
I know. In 2017, more than 10,000 children were exposed to washing detergent.
Well, oh, no. What does that mean, though?
I mean, does that mean their clothes were actually washed in washing detergent, hopefully?
See, that's just it, though. They're not saying. They're just pulling these statistics anywhere they can get them to go, my God, this is such a huge thing.
Yeah.
This substance is poisonous and poses serious health risk if ingested.
And then since it is the Mirror, Dr. Alfred Algegris Jr., because that's a real name, managing director of Florida Poison Control, said the fad may be life-threatening. Most pod eating seems to happen in America, which is the Mirror saying Americans are stupid. But it goes so far that there is a consumer reports notice as to what's in a laundry pod and what eating a laundry pod can do to you. The problem with this article is it uses a bunch of science words to scare the crap out of you.
Well, I like some of the, like one of them, there's a couple memes are there. Kids are eating laundry detergent pods. Don't they know how expensive those things are?
I know, right?
And they really are expensive.
Yeah. But if you go to Know Your Meme to look up eating Tide Pods.
There's all sorts of memes like when the Tide Pod rolls in.
Here's the thing.
Britney. You got Britney Spears eating a Tide Pod.
Yeah. Here's the thing. Interest in this subject has been dead until a month ago. And then it skyrocketed like per 100 searches and stuff like that. So it's ridiculous that all of a sudden, out of nowhere, we're going to just start eating Tide Pods. Yeah.
Yeah.
But it's really interesting because the fact that we have to have it explained to us on Consumer Reports.
What's in a laundry pod?
Yeah.
Laundry detergent. Right?
No, like I was saying, these science jargon to scare the hell out of people. Long chain polymers. You mean like peroxide and soap?
Yeah.
I mean, you know, ethanol and hydrogen, you know. Yeah, pretty much. So don't put it in your mouth because it'll eat through the lining of your mouth and your stomach.
Yeah.
Yeah. But no, it's still happening.
You would have to regurgitate the ball almost immediately to avoid injury. And given the physical size of the pod, it's not something you could just vomit up easily and have it remain intact.
Unless, of course, you want to make an edible Tide laundry pod.
Because that's a good idea.
Yeah, to stop you from eating.
Wait. How exactly does the Tide pod kill you?
Oh, okay.
The gruesomeness does not stop with diarrhea and vomiting. Without medical attention, your lungs may start to fill with the fluid. Right?
Yeah.
Which will in turn make it very difficult for you to breathe and eventually send you into respiratory arrest. Dun, dun, dun.
Oh, God.
And if it gets into your bloodstream, vital organs, including your brain, it can also kill you dead. Right? It can be a short path to seizures, coma, and eventually death.
Okay.
There is no hard and fast rule for how quickly this process will run its course, but you're going to die anyway, right? It's basically what it's saying.
Mm-hmm.
If you eat them, you will die. It's a direct toxic effect on the central nervous system. Most of the people who've died from accidentally ingesting laundry pods died within hours to days. Huh.
Well, I'm sure if it were a small child, then yeah, probably within a couple of hours, sadly. If it was a human, or I mean a full-grown human or adult, then it probably takes longer. Plus, an adult could probably eat more of them.
Yeah.
But the link I was talking about earlier, where you could make your own, people have resorted to making their own edible Tide laundry pods.
In order to keep our kids from eating Tide laundry pods and killing themselves, we're going to give you this free recipe on how to make the fake ones, right?
Here's the thing.
Like, don't eat that one, little Jimmy. Eat this one over here.
It started as a Tumblr post with complete directions, including unflavored gelatin, condensed milk, water, and colored Jell-O.
Oh, gross. And
if you don't have the moon-shaped molds, forget about it. You can basically try to do something that squish them into place, but it doesn't really work out that well. However, Tumblr forced them to take the post down.
It's like, no, we don't want to give you an alternative on not to kill yourself. So we'll just keep running the Tide Pods.
Yes. And then there is a hard candy company in Tallahassee who is making their own version of Tide Pod hard candies. And it's a very beautiful video.
Oh, this is so stupid.
I know. And that's the thing. They keep referring
like
to
like this little shitty Tide Pod that they're showing here that you could make.
Yeah, that's
the little candy thing.
Yeah.
That's the kind of stuff we're going to go, don't buy that. That's an imitation Tide Pod. Like when they show pictures of like drugs and they have like little cartoon characters on them and stuff like that. Like, this is dangerous. If you see your kid eating this.
So this, what you're saying is this is next DARE campaign?
I don't know what's going on with
and
this.
And I kind of think that's what it is. The fact that we always want to protect our kids from possible, if not fake, threats. I mean, we had the war on drugs, which truly, everything I learned in DARE never happened to me.
Yeah.
And now, like, going on, I'm an adult, and I can't really see firsthand what's going on. So I'm subject to what the media exposes me to. And the media is exposing me to this thing that keeps getting called the forbidden fruit, which is a laundry detergent pack. How we've gotten from, hey, kids, don't do drugs, to, hey, kids, don't obviously stick chemicals in your mouth, has just been retarded. I'm sorry. I don't...
Retarded?
I mean...
How dare you? That is not appropriate.
Okay. But I kind of feel like we've run out of things to protect our kids from.
It's just the beginning of 2018. We're not even like 14 days... Well, we are. I guess we are 14 days in. But I mean, it's like, it's just going to get worse. I think 2018 will be our most stupid year ever.
I hope so.
Why?
Because it gives us show content.
Well, I mean, yeah, but this is kind of sad.
But I don't necessarily think it's because we're stupid. I think this
was purely done.
Yeah.
To over dramatize, or however you say that, make this, you know, to where it gave some. I mean, come on! Like the news is reporting on this, like this is some freaking epidemic.
Yeah.
And it's not. It's not all these. I mean, what? How many people were exposed to and had an adverse reaction to laundry detergent last year? Or in 2012, for example?
Yeah, in 2012. No idea.
Yeah. Nobody does. Because you could take these numbers and just make them up. And look like 15,000 people. That's bullshit.
Well, I'm sure you can look it up
on you've got people that are allergic.
CDC website.
Well, I mean, there's a whole... Well, yeah. You probably could. But see, I don't even know if I want to go that far.
Yeah.
Like, do we have to actually justify that we're really not that damn stupid? You know what I mean? And I think that this whole thing is slightly subversive on the news.
Yeah.
You know?
And the thing is, the news is being subversive.
The news is being subversive.
Yeah, they're trying to get attention, and in response, it is backfiring. But they're failing to report how it's backfiring, how exposure to a bad idea causes more bad ideas.
Well, they're not gonna, because that's not what they want. That's not the message they want to portray
at
all.
The problem is, that's responsible journalism.
But You just said responsible journalism. That doesn't exist anymore.
True. So
I mean, there used to be a thing where you would never do a news article about stuff that wasn't actual or factually accurate or anything like that. And now it's like they don't even bother.
Yeah.
The only time they actually bother to research is if somebody brings a lawsuit against them or brings them under, you know, scrutiny. Yeah.
And that's the thing, because they don't...
It's sensationalistic journalism is what it is.
Sensationalism is back, as well as irresponsible journalism is back. Society's response to it is...
When you look at the whole fake news thing.
Society's response to it is exasperating the issue, or memes. Oh, you're going to say we're eating Tide Pods? Here's some more memes. Heck, here's some people doing fake Snapchat videos.
It's like a joke that all the adults are not in on.
Yeah.
And then all the kids are. And they're like, really? They really
think... And that's the thing. Kids are using less drugs. Kids are having less dangerous accidents. Kids are a little more responsible these days, which is good on them.
Hmm.
But then, you know, we're not teaching them things like, you know, planning their careers and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But
like,
that's a whole nother conversation.
How to pay your taxes.
Yeah.
How to pay your power bill. You know, how to be adulting.
Yeah.
And it's like we talked about in one of our other podcasts, like that term didn't even exist, adulting.
Until like what?
Now it has to have a term, like, you know, things you do to prove that you can be an adult, right? Yeah. Like paying your taxes or getting your oil changed or whatever. Got a lot of adulting to do today.
Yeah.
You know, back in my day, we just called that living. Got a lot of living to do today. There's a lot of stuff I got to do. Got to go to the grocery store. Got to change a tire. Got to do whatever.
But they also didn't have Tide Pods back then.
No, they didn't have Tide Pods back then because we were smart enough to go, let me take the little green scoop, right, and put two scoops in the washing machine and off you went. You know? And this is what I think is funny is like, yeah, these little Tide Pods, you get like 16 of them for like $6.
Yeah.
When you can buy a whole jug of crap for like that, it's like, oh, these Tide Pods are so convenient, you just throw it in there.
Oh, but that jug is full of fillers and fragrances, which is
well, all laundry
so
detergent
the
is
Tide
actually
Pods, you
yeah,
know?
Well, I mean, and that's the thing, all of them are, and that's why a lot of people actually have allergic reactions to them, because there is a lot of things that are in the laundry detergent that causes people to have issues.
Hmm.
Yeah. Optical brighteners and whiteners, emulsifiers to keep it from foaming up too much, but they actually have to add stuff in there to make it foam and all this other crazy junk.
Yeah.
And if you really break it down to the main ingredients that you need for laundry detergent, like I've done a YouTube video on this where I used to make my own, you know, where it was less expensive back then, to where you could basically take the main ingredients and get, buy them and then make your own laundry detergent in bulk where you could use effectively 2 tablespoons to do your entire load and do laundry for a year. It only cost you like $20.
Yeah.
But now, when the recession hit and really people start getting all scared and tried to find alternative means to save money, all those ingredients that you could buy back in the olden days that used to be like $5-6 total,
yeah,
are now like the same price as regular laundry detergent. So you might as well just buy regular laundry detergent.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hmm. So yeah. No matter what, you can't win.
Nope.
Okay.
Better eat them laundry detergent tabs while you can. You know, if you're really going to eat those things, I mean, you know, that's just stupid. Really? If I seen a kid doing it, I would probably smack them, like, really hard, like, to try to save their life. You know what I mean?
Yes.
Like, and smack it out of them.
And then we'd probably end up with a lawsuit.
Maybe.
So, yeah.
Maybe.
Yeah. Because I don't think New Mexico...
Well, that used to be the answer for everything back in the day.
Just smack.
If you were hysterical, you would just get smacked and it'd bring you back to reality, right?
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Great. No.
Yeah, good times.
So...
Oh. I don't know, man. I got smacked a couple times growing up, and guess what? Whatever it was I was doing, I never did it again. I know a lot of people are like, that was child abuse. That's not child abuse. No, there is a distinct difference between child abuse and disciplining your kids.
Yeah.
You know, and sometimes you just reflex smack the crap out of them because when a kid tries to kill themselves, that's your reaction is to beat them half to death so they won't ever do it again. It's just, and people are like, well, that's just not natural. And it's, you see it in nature, too.
Mm-hmm.
You see, like, the lions and the little, what do you call the little lion babies?
Cubs.
Little cubs.
Mm-hmm.
They do something dumb, and mama comes over and bites them on the top of the head and throws them around. Like, hey, you're going to kill yourself, stupid.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like that.
Yeah.
So, got to stop doing dumb stuff.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I think that's part of it, too. We rely so much on social media and junk like that that it's a hard line between the age of the youths that are out there that know what's funny and what's hip and what's a joke, and the older people who are just like what? No, that's not funny. Don't do that. In other words, since they don't get the joke, they don't know where that line is, and they just don't know that they're not supposed to cross it.
You know, eventually we're going to be those people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, we already are.
Oh.
Yeah. I mean, come on, man. The only reason why kids actually use Facebook is just to talk to their parents, because their parents keep using Facebook. They're all using, like, Snapchat and Tumblr and other stuff.
Yeah.
Hmm. Yep. Okay. And, you know, Snapchat is just, I've been on Snapchat for a while. I just don't like it.
I have Tumblr automated. I haven't even bothered to go on there because I was
don't
like,
tell nobody that. Well, the kids don't use Tumblr either.
Well, they...
Not really. Not anymore.
The ones younger than me do.
No, so they're all weird about Snapchat, man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, there's some Tumblr.
Hey, if you're like 12 years old and listening to this podcast, first off, go out and get a life. But hey, if you're using something super cool out there,
like laundry pods,
and you want to tell the adults what the hip new cool thing is, so we could just get in there and wreck it for you, just let us know.
Yeah.
You can call us at 575-208-4025. Leave us a message. So, yeah. Okay, so you've seen this. I've seen this.
I had no idea until way after it happened.
Well, I've seen this, and it wasn't a big deal, so I'm like, whatever. You know, this kind of thing does happen every once in a while.
Yeah. But I think with everyone being so fired up with, you know, North Korea and stuff like that, you know.
No.
Yeah. That's the reaction that's going on in the news right now. But there was a Hawaii missile alert, and the title of this article is How One Employee Pushed the Wrong Button and Caused a Wave of Panic.
I bet you that employee was like 50 years old.
Well, everyone in this photo
and not familiar with how the internet, social media, all this newfangled technology works.
Yeah.
I bet you that's what it is.
Everyone in the top photo of this article is over 50. But funny that you say they don't know how things work, because what was supposed to happen during...
What it happened was...
This was a day to initiate an internal test of the emergency missile warning system.
Okay, hold on. The name of this place is the Hawaii Emergency Management Agency.
HEMA.
Whatever.
Kind of like FEMA.
I mean, think about it. If you were a kid, college kid, are you going to work there?
No.
No. Emergency management agencies and stuff like that. That's for, like, older people, man.
Unless you're a smart kid, that is a bank job.
But they won't give it to you because they're gonna. That's the kind of job you got to work in. I've been in part of emergency management for 75 years, you know, that kind of thing.
That's true. But, man, that would be a good job. But, yeah, these older-looking employees were sent to practice sending emergency alerts to the public, and there was this internal testing system they were supposed to use. This drill has been set up with some regularity. Hawaii reinstated its Cold War era nuclear warning sirens amongst growing fears of attack by North Korea. So that meant everyone needed to be trained again.
Right.
So around 8:05 a.m., the Hawaii emergency employee initiated the internal test according to a timeline released by the state. From a drop-down menu on a computer program, he saw two options: test missile alert and missile alert. He was supposed to choose the former, as much of the world now knows. He chose the latter.
You know why? Because this is the same kind of dude who, when he gets a message on his computer, says, "Are you sure you want to delete those files?" He goes, "Damn it." Because he's got yes or no option here, right? Oh, well, if I don't really know enough about computers and stuff to know that if I just... So I'm just going to say yes and hope that my computer still works.
So this happened at 8:05 a.m. He chose the wrong one at 8:05 a.m. At 8:07 a.m., an errant alert went out to scores of Hawaii residents.
Well, that's
and
awesome
tourists.
That it takes exactly 2 minutes for that message to go out.
That kind of scares me. And the message was, ballistic missile threat inbound to Hawaii. Seek immediate shelter. This is not a drill. This also scrolled across television screens throughout Hawaii.
Yeah.
With the additional suggestions, if you're indoors, stay indoors. If you're outdoors, seek immediate shelter. Remain indoors, away from windows. If you're driving, pull over. Seek safety. This sparked a wave of panic as thousands of people, many assuming they only had minutes to live, scrambled to seek shelter and say their final goodbyes to loved ones. The situation was exacerbated by a 38-minute gap between the initial alert and subsequent wireless alerts stating that the missile warning was a mistake. So you had over half an hour of people having heart attacks, pooping themselves, and giving their final goodbyes to all their loved ones.
This is the equivalent of, instead of sending an email just to one person or to your department, you send it to the entire company.
With a middle finger.
And then nobody knows about it.
Yeah.
No, I don't think it was any malicious intent involved. So they just like, yeah, it's cool. The coffee machine is down. So they send out like a production down warning that goes to... email, right? And it goes to the entire company and people are like freaking out.
Yeah.
So, and they're like, "Did you know what you just did?" You're like, "What are you talking about?" You just said everybody to missile. No, it was a test, man. It didn't go out to everybody. Yeah,
governor,
it did. Are you sure? Yeah.
The governor of Hawaii, he apologized for the pain and confusion for the wayward alert and said it had been a mistake made during a standard procedure at the changeover of a shift and an employee pushed the wrong button. That's still not even correct. But one day after the debacle, more details are emerging how the mistake occurred and growing calls for accountability and re-examination of the wireless emergency alert system happened.
Well, yeah.
My thing is, why was the testing on a live module? I mean, or because, on the system?
You don't, how else are you going to test it?
You recreate the program No.
This is just a simple mistake. So what they're going to try to do is, because this mistake was made,
yeah,
and people got a little freaked out, they're going to try to reinvent the entire system, and it's going to break what's been in place since the, what, late 50s?
Yeah. But they're asking for this guy to get fired.
And that's bullshit. The guy made a simple mistake. He pressed the wrong, or he selected the wrong selection, and people got scared. Does he deserve to be fired for it? I mean, we've all made mistakes. Why should he get fired for it? And you've never sent an email to everyone instead of just one person?
See, I don't think he should be fired. I think, I do feel, though, that the whole process needs to get reexamined.
Well, I'm sure it will when it comes to their testing, but I mean, how long has this been going on when there's been no issues at all?
Years.
Okay. And they also have this system set up to where sometimes environmental conditions set off the alarms, like for tsunami warnings and stuff like that.
I mean, but here's the thing. Part of what worsened this whole situation was that there's no system in place at the state emergency agency for correcting an error. Like here in New Mexico, when we get Amber Alerts for missing kids, sadly,
not run through New Mexico.
That happened, no, because we have those ones, because with the Navajo Nation girl who went missing and she unfortunately was murdered, that is run through New Mexico.
It's actually run through a third-party company that does all the Amber Alerts.
Hmm.
Yeah, so it's not run, it's not so run the through state, the state.
Because the big problem was the Navajo girl, the Navajo Nation isn't involved in the Amber Alert system. So we had to make changes this year to incorporate them into the Amber Alert system. Because, sadly, we had somebody pass away and bad things happened.
Well,
But we get a lot of Amber Alerts out here, and they're very quick to cancel the Amber Alert as soon as the person's found.
Well, they are. And the reason why nobody canceled this alert, I'm sure, is because unless they were by a TV and seen it scrolling across, they didn't know it was going down.
Hmm.
You know what I mean?
Okay.
I mean, it's like when you have a radio station and they're supposed to do the little test every day where they say, this is the test of the emergency warning system. Had this been a real... Unless they're actually, playing it, they don't hear it. So this dude was sitting at his desk or whatever, and the last thing he had to do was do the test, and he selected the wrong thing, and he probably didn't hear anything about it. And the oncoming shift, right?
Yeah.
They didn't know anything was going on either. That's really the problem. The problem is the test was conducted at the wrong time. You shouldn't be doing a test when you have a shift change. It should be done 2 hours before.
Okay. Yeah, I can.
That'll fix the entire thing. Let's not fire people. Let's not revamp the entire system. So the Hawaiian governor, what's his name? David Icke? Ige? How do you say his name? Ige? Who is a Democrat, by the way, because I guess they felt it necessary to put a D next to his name and for the Washington Post.
Yeah.
I mean, he apologized. There you go. It's unfortunate. It's regrettable. We're going to fix this so it doesn't happen again. We're going to make some policy changes. But there. I mean, it was an alert. It happened. It scared people. After about 30 minutes of not being burned to death by a missile attack, I'm pretty sure I would have moved about my business.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But people are going to react to this in a way that doesn't make sense, and they're going to be, it's going to be like, oh my God, look what you did, and social outcry and stuff, and they did that to Trump, right?
Yeah.
And this is my rant, because I have a little rant section that happens here, right?
Yeah.
And, it kind of goes like this. Okay. So Donald Trump stayed on the golf course as Hawaii panicked.
Oh, okay.
Now, correct me if I'm wrong, isn't he in Hawaii for one of his 120 days of vacation so far?
I'm not sure, actually. We're...
Okay, so critics are blasting Donald Trump for continuing to golf Saturday while frantic Hawaii residents rushed for cover after a false cell phone alarm about an incoming missile ballistic missile inbound alert came in, right?
He's in Florida. He was in Mar-a-Lago.
Okay.
Yeah.
So he was on the course, at Trump International Golf Club, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's where he was. And it's like the alert was issued at 1:09 p.m. Eastern, according to the press, right? His motorcade didn't leave for the club for Mar-a-Lago until 1:38. Okay.
Yeah.
So, although Hawaii's Emergency Management Agency quickly tweeted that the initial warning was an error, it took 38 minutes before a second mobile alert declared that the first one was an error, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So, what they're saying is that Trump should have tweeted something as soon as he found out it wasn't an alert.
I thought we all want him to tweet less.
No.
Yeah. See?
So... And this is the kind of thing. And here's how the article goes. And of course, this is from Huffington Post. It says, as of Saturday evening, Trump had not issued any personal statement or tweet about the scare. He did tweet about fake news and again called Michael Wolff's book, whatever, you know. And so what is he supposed to do? Is he supposed to tweet as soon as he found out it wasn't a problem? No. He's not, because he's the president of the United States. He has to wait because there are other people in your local and state government that have steps that they do and take care of all their business that they have to take care of before the freaking president of the United States gets involved.
We are no longer like that. While you have described the appropriate process for things, everyone expects everyone else, right up to the president, to be reactionary. Even though... if we just go back one president, Obama, yes, he had somebody doing his Twitter constantly. That person was with him at all times because, yeah, Obama wasn't sending all those tweets. He had a social media management team.
Yeah.
Which is what you do when your government is run just like a corporation. And since Trump is a businessman, but he's not tech savvy, his Twitter is all personal. And...
so what would have happened
if he responded to the tweet?
Yeah, if he would have responded with a tweet saying, watch out, Hawaii, you got a missile coming inbound, and then there wasn't one.
It is a damned if you do, damned if you don't, because we are expecting him to be reactionary regardless. Because
and here's the thing,
too. As long as there is a reaction, we can rip him apart for being a terrible person.
Yeah, and even Montel Williams was like, anyone else wondering why the hell Donald Trump didn't tweet about this morning's false alarm in Hawaii? Too busy with golfing or doesn't care since it's not about him?
It was a false alarm.
It was a false alarm. And you also had the governor of Hawaii who was taking care of it and put the message out there. It should not be the president of the United States' responsibility or wherewithal or have the wherewithal to jump the chain of command.
But then having said that, that argument there, it doesn't feed into when Trump does take up certain state issues and provides his opinion, people, not his official
stance. And see, this is the problem we have, too. He tweets a lot of stuff and people just respect or just expect him to say something on everything.
Yeah.
Obama did it, too.
I know.
For a lot of different things, especially when there's any kind of involvement of a police, a police being involved in any reaction. These guys are the bad guys before anything was even figured out. So the fact that Trump didn't respond with anything tells me this is really a non-issue.
I know.
Because if there really was an attack on Hawaii, we would not have this conversation, not a bit.
No, it would be.
And we can't say Hawaii is, they're all skittish because of Pearl Harbor. This is not at all. This is, again, looking at, him, he's damned if he do, he's damned if he doesn't. And it reminds me back when George Bush, right?
Yeah.
Was sitting there reading a story to children when he heard about the 9/11 attacks.
And people were like,
you should have jumped up and freaked out and ran out there and scared the shit out of all those kids, but you finished the book and went and took care of business. Because what could he have done?
Yeah.
There is things that happen when bad stuff happens. Right?
You can conduct yourself like a man.
You just wait. Don't
I'm sorry.
Even do that.
That's not it at all.
I mean, there's things that, okay, you're the president, you've been the president for a year, or you've been elected. You haven't been part of the system that's been put in place with all the wars that we've had and everything else. Well, there is a policy, there is a procedure for stuff like this.
Yeah.
That gets put in place a long time ago. So he can't override it, and things have to happen, and there's an order that things actually happen in. And so he would have no effect over this whatsoever. Because if it really was, Like, he would be in the air already. He'd be evacuated somewhere else. You'd have all the councils. You'd have everybody being evacuated. There's things that happen that move on down the line when something bad happens, and people are just idiots. They're just going to, hey, I can't believe you didn't say anything. It's not his damn purview. Because what would happen if Trump would have said, good job, Hawaii, for your false alarm? Because then you got the damn governor of Hawaii. He's like, what are you doing, man? This is my freaking state.
Yeah.
You know, you took away my power, my responsibility. And they wouldn't be able to do anything, really, until they enacted a FEMA event. Because they'd have to determine where the missile attack came from, if it actually was a missile attack. It's just, this is
and
my
And for
rant.
Trump to step down and not say something regarding this incident, which is at the state level.
He didn't step down at all. He just...
Well, he is...
He didn't respond because he waited for the appropriate reaction to happen from the people that are governing that state.
For him to not have a reaction, and to allow the state to manage the situation, because the governor did have it under control, I think it speaks to Trump's, I guess his tactic, in the sense that he does need to strengthen his relations with the individual
states. I
don't
even think that's it at all. Okay. That's completely not it, and I'll tell you why. He respects chain of command.
Okay.
He knows there's chain of command that's supposed to happen. He respects it. The only thing is that he can't keep his damn personal opinions to himself. That's his real problem.
Yeah.
But he will let the chain of command do its thing.
Yeah.
But at the same time, though, if he needs to get involved, he will get involved, and that's where the problem lies. People expected him to get involved with this, and he didn't. Because they really wanted him to get involved with it, and then when it didn't turn out right, they would have had something else to
get
on him about.
Kept his mouth shut, and the fact
he probably got a message like this: "Hey, there was a ballistic missile, false alarm, that went out, you know, through the emergency management system in Hawaii," and he was like, "Oh, okay. What do we got to do? Nothing. Yeah, there's nothing we can do. It's just a false alarm." You know, the governor of Hawaii is already taking care of it. Okay, good.
I find it interesting that he, in this situation, you know, he's not responding. And he's, my interpretation of stepping away from the situation by not engaging, okay?
Yeah.
So stepping aside from the situation, I actually think it would help him in this situation because that's a Democratic governor. That's a Democratic state.
Yeah.
You know? So, I don't know.
And a senior administrative official told Politico that there was no military response around the president during the incident because there was no actual threat detected by the military.
Hmm.
Huh. So he didn't react because there was no threat. You know what I mean? It's like, what is he going to do here?
Yeah. Like I said,
an informer Pentagon, criticized the president in a tweet for continuing a round of golf on his taxpayer-funded vacation as Hawaiians braced for a non-existent ballistic missile strike.
Yep.
No, I threw that part in there because former Pentagon official Colonel Morris Davis criticized the president, right?
Mm-hmm.
Here was his tweet. For 38 minutes, American citizens in Hawaii braced for a ballistic missile strike. And Donald Trump continued his round of golf in Florida on his 120th taxpayer-funded vacation day in less than a year. Okay, Colonel Morris Davis, let's put some perspective into this. He hasn't taken a paycheck at all. How many vacation days do you have in a year?
I don't know.
How many weekends are in a year?
52-ish?
That's weeks.
Oh.
I wish there was 52 weekends in a year. Let's see. Let's ask the Google real quick. How many weekends in a year? First result. Imagine that. Okay, so... Oh, here we go. This is getting complicated now. I'm trying to figure out this crap. 52 weeks in a year... So, I don't know. How do we figure this out, man? What kind of math do we need to use to figure this out? 52 weeks? So, if there's 52, some kind of thing we divide this by? I don't know.
There are 52 Saturdays in the year 2018. So, because of that, there are 52 weekends.
And there's also 52 weeks.
Yes. So my original answer of 52 was pretty spot on, okay?
If you think Omi was wrong, let me know. Okay, so hold on a second. If there's 52 Saturdays and 52 Sundays, if we multiply it by 2, that's 104. Right?
That's 104 days.
Okay, so that's 104 days.
Yes.
Now, how many state holidays are... I'm trying to figure this out here. I need a piece of paper and something to write on. So how many government holidays are there in a year?
How many government holidays?
Yeah, like federal holidays, where banks have off and all that stuff.
Oh, wow. Nobody's got a list.
That's what makes this hard.
Yeah.
Okay, so 104 days, right? That's mm-hmm. the total of days. How many days, how many government holidays...
Approximately 10 federal holidays in 2018.
Okay, so 2018 has 10. That's 124.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah.
So that's 124 days.
Sure.
So how many vacation days does he get in a year? I don't know. He's the president. So if we do how many vacation... Okay, so anyway, what it boils down to is... They make it sound like he is taking so many days off, but I mean, everybody, okay, I don't work the weekends, so I get 110 days off, 104 days off.
Mm-hmm.
I get federal holidays off, right? So that's 114 days.
Hmm.
Plus, I took 2 weeks of vacation, right? And that was 14 days. So I've taken just as many days as Donald Trump has.
Yeah.
Huh. Me, a regular person, has taken just as many days off as the president has.
Huh.
Interesting.
Presidential vacations, which Commander-in-Chief took the most time off. Somebody complained about a 17-day vacation taken by President Trump.
Hmm. Huh.
So, let's see. Oh, it doesn't say who took the most.
No, it doesn't. No,
of course not.
But anyway, getting back to it again.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know. What else can we say? There's not really a whole lot. Because then we just took the show and just drove it into the ground.
I know, right?
Like what?
Wow.
I just don't... I mean... Okay, so he's taken 152 vacation days in a year.
Yeah.
So what? He doesn't take a paycheck. Right?
Yeah.
I mean, to me, that counts for something. And granted, he is a millionaire, so whatever. But, you know, hey, I have the ability to take just as many days as he took.
Hmm.
And I'm just a regular person. So to act like he's supposed to be, you know, nobody said, you know, hey, Obama took a bunch of vacation too.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know. Anyway, that's all I got to say about that.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. So I think we're going to take it's commercial time. We'll take a little commercial time. I'm going to give him a little coffee. It's going to be great.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Hey, you're listening to Cheap Geek Podcast. We'll be right back. And we're back. Okay, so that was my rant. Was what do you expect him to do? He's damned if he does, damned if he doesn't. You know, it's just like, come on, man.
Yeah.
Just give the orange guy a chance.
And I kind of feel that he's actually making some efforts. That's why I felt that this may have indirectly some political, you know, motivation in the sense that he's, you know, not going on Twitter and being a crude in some sense. But I don't know.
Because he could have said, good job, stupids.
Yeah, could have. And no, this is a Democratic state with a Democratic governor, and he chose, well, we don't know what he actually chose to do. We don't know what
I think
what
he thought this
happened.
Was a non-event, so he didn't make it event. And, you know, everybody else is trying to make it out to be more than what it is. But
yeah. Now, my rant actually has to do specifically with...
What? You have a rant?
Yeah, I actually have one. Mine has to do with New Mexico. So, I just saw a news article today, and it reminded me of some things that have been going on here in the New Mexico job market. We have a very hard time retaining a strong workforce. And it's funny because this is the 2018 legislative session for New Mexico's like government, state government, where they're going to try to push new things like, you know, the right to work and paid leave and things like that. And the whole, not just the work culture here, but society as a whole feels that, yes, while New Mexico is a state that cherishes family and friends and time with those people you care about, it also has a tendency to be a place where your work obligations are not important. And when companies move here, they try to figure out, why can't we retain employees? Why can't we have employees that show up or, you know, do their job? And it seems to start at a very young age, because there is a new article for New Mexico parents who can now face charges for their kids missing school too much. We have a terrible attendance rate here.
Criminal charges.
We have a terrible time having our kids go to school here, especially in like the more economically depressed and rural areas. Like, this is actually happening in an area called Clovis, New Mexico. And there's an entire county out there where they're going to get tough on parents who don't encourage or make their kids go to school. And now there are two moms who are facing criminal charges for their kids having excessive unexcused absences. Now, the problem here is that, like here in Albuquerque, I think kids can miss 12 days of school. It's like 9 to 12 days of school.
Huh.
That's a lot. I mean, compared back home, like nephews and stuff like that, and if they miss 3 days, they might actually fail.
Is it like unexcused absences, though?
Yeah. Well, that's where it gets like murky, because like in most public schools, even if you have a note, if the note or your medical condition surpasses certain things, you can still be held back a grade or fail or something like that. But here in New Mexico, kids are just not going to school and parents aren't doing anything about it. They're like, oh, you don't want to go to school? Fine, I'm going to work, or I'm going to go party, sadly. And that's what's going on.
I'm
going to
go
here.
Party, sadly. So, I'm at your party, right? But I'm not having a good time. I'm kind of sad.
But there's, you know, this is students with more than 10 unexcused absences in a school year is considered habitual truancy.
Ah, unexcused. Okay.
Yeah. So, yeah. Now, the district attorney for this area has charged two mothers so far. One of them was arrested on Tuesday for allowing her 6-year-old daughter to continually be tardy and miss school. Wow. Now, there's another mom. She has a warrant out for her arrest due to her 15-year-old son having too many absences from high school. Now, some parents believe there need to be more resources to help kids stay in school. It's just not fair. I think there needs to be more resources for parents and not just threats of legal action. I'm sorry. These places, New Mexico has plenty of resources.
I don't know. There needs to be a better way to do this, because what if you're in a position where you are working a job where you can't have any kind of criminal infractions at all, and then your kid misses a day, or it's not counted correctly, or whatever, you know, and the issue becomes where an excused absence has really become unexcused, and all of a sudden there's a you know, like a warrant issued for your arrest, and they go arrest you at work, because I can totally expect that to happen here in New Mexico, and you lose your freaking job.
I would disagree, only in the sense that the whole miscounting thing.
I don't know. It's going
to
happen.
You would have to get up there. You'd have to get towards 8, at least, for a miscount to 10, you know? And if there were a computer error, that would be immediately dropped, I would hope.
I don't, this, yeah. They locked somebody up in New Mexico for 2 years, and he wasn't even charged at all.
That's true.
Under suspicion of drunk driving, he had this guy locked up for 2 years. He had to extract his own tooth when he was in jail.
Actually, wasn't that in the same county?
Yes. Yes, it was.
But here's the thing. This whole county is screwed, because even the grown-ups...
I mean, I get it. They're trying to send a message saying, hey, grown-ups, you need to... this is serious business, because if your kids don't go to school, they're not going to go to work, you know, and all this other stuff. You need to make them productive members of society and all that stuff. But there's got to be a different way to do it than basically haul them off and arrest them.
How are you supposed to do that when the own parents half the time aren't productive members of society?
Well, I mean, there you go. We're just supposed... Okay, since... I don't think this is going to fix anything. Personally,
I kind of hope it's like an idle threat, but taken seriously.
Well, I mean, I think that they need to. I know in my heart that they're not going to pick somebody who is like really broke and super poor and getting government assistance and everything else to make them the example.
I would think
they're going to find a parent who has a job, who is married, who has a house. Right. And maybe two cars, because that way it's easier, you know, for them to go, well, these parents are just being lazy. And that way when they arrest them and it still sends the same message, it won't be like, oh, you're singling this family out because they're poor.
I don't know. Actually,
you know
I'm
what I mean?
Clicking on this one to see about the woman. Oh, while the student may face... While the student may face academic consequences, the parent can face 6 months in jail and a $500 fine. Now,
so again, your kid misses 7 days of school. You get arrested. The judge has a bad day. Puts you in jail for 6 months. You lose your job. You lose your house. You lose your car. You lose your freaking kids. I don't trust the system in New Mexico. Not a bit.
I agree. But I also... while the system is broken, so are the people. That is my point with this rant. The people are broken. So no amount of changing the system or changing the consequences is really going to fix things. I mean, some amount of changing the consequences.
Well, I mean, even the district attorney, right? Andrew Reeb says that students who missed more than 10 days are more likely to drop out of school and later commit crimes.
That's true.
It's not. It's not true, because this goes into where you get pigeonholed or stereotyped based off of statistics, and statistics say when your six-year-old misses 10 days of school, they're going to drop out of school and commit crimes.
This is
the logic that they're using. And don't get me wrong, I think that, I mean, something needs to be done, but I think they really need to stop sort of using these statistical measures when they don't necessarily apply to children, because they're putting the same... This is profiling.
True. I would agree on that. But, you know, this whole six-year-old in this... Granted, I know, to this day, I still know someone when she was six, she actually had brain cancer and survived. But that whole year in school, she missed a whole lot of school. But... I'm pretty sure she had doctor's notes for all of that, you know?
Yeah.
And it was pretty tough on her parents. But in this specific example, I don't feel that... I don't know if it's really going to teach anything. I mean, I'm hoping it scares the crap out of people and that we don't hear anything more about this article, but we won't. Because I used to work at a call center here in New Mexico where we had people who would miss a whole week of work, or they'd show up every day a half hour late for weeks.
Yeah, I just think there should be a different way to go about doing it.
Because I
don't trust the system that's put in place to enforce this sort of thing.
But here's the thing about New Mexico. The system isn't going to fix it. Severe penalties aren't going to fix it either. It is an attitude and a cultural change, shift, and that's not going to happen.
It's not going to change. I mean, you've got like in Clovis.
Yeah.
Clovis man arrested for 10th DUI.
Yeah.
10th.
Yes.
Yeah.
At one point, Clovis had a statistic within the past like 5 years of a 36% unemployment rate. Great. Well,
I mean,
it's like, so, and it happens here in the Southwest.
Yeah.
And I don't know what's going to fix it, because these severe penalties or different consequences or different rules or implementing more programs, it's not going to help anything.
There's got to be different ways. That's all.
And that's what,
I mean, really, we got to hold the parents accountable. I get it.
Yeah.
But until you actually have employers that hold the people that are working for them accountable, it won't affect the parents that much.
Which is why a lot of employers won't move to Clovis. That's why
a lot of employers don't want to move or trying to move out of New Mexico.
Yeah. There was one employer that moved to Clovis within the past 2 years, and they've left. You know?
Yeah.
So... And it's not, I'm picking on Clovis, New Mexico.
Picking on them at all, because that's where that's their law.
Which is messed up.
They put it in place. I mean, that's their, you're not picking on them. That's something that they're doing. Well, and granted, they have to do it based off a situation that Clovis itself is in. But I just don't like the idea that, you know, I just see that the people that are trying to do the right thing are going to get hemmed up in this.
I agree. So. And it bothers me though, because, oh, grown-ups can't make it to work. Grown-ups can't be, you know, whatever. So let's start early with all these kids who are constantly skipping school.
Like, I mean, here's that's where it starts, and then it gets to like this. New Mexico lawmaker wants schools to text parents before every test.
Yeah, I saw that one. I wasn't going to talk about that one.
It's like, no. And see, you know,
yeah.
I don't, they're going to take it to the intention is supposed to be good, and it's supposed to be there to enact a positive change, but then it doesn't stop there, and it becomes this ripple in the pond.
Yeah.
Where, I mean, you have like, you're going to get text messages every 2 seconds because your kid's got a test that day. Well, what happens if you didn't hear about the test from your kid and you're at work? What are you supposed to do? You know, just want you to be aware of it. But then, you know, they say, well, you know, your kid did poorly on this test, and you're like, yeah, you know, and we sent you a text about the test. You know, weren't you aware that they had the test? It's like, I did, because he's, no, this is just the bullshit.
Yeah.
It's just the bullshits.
I don't know. I kind of feel it's like grasping at straws to fix a problem that's beyond, you know, penalties and consequences. Yeah. So, yeah. But, that's enough about my rant. Again,
this is how New Mexico is, right? In Santa Fe, there was a dog who is abandoned at Dunkin' Donuts.
Aww. Right?
Dog's name is Jackie. Had a note around his little neck saying that she was free.
That's just wrong.
Yeah, so she was taken in by the Santa Fe Animal Shelter and put up for adoption.
Okay.
But that's New Mexico. I have a problem. I don't know how to deal with it. I'm going to let everyone deal with it. And that way I won't have to. I'll make society responsible for my issue so that I don't have to deal with it. Instead of going, hey, I need help. I can't take care of this dog. Can anyone help me? No, I'm just going to drop it off with a little note around the neck that says free. And then I'll let everyone else take care of it.
Gosh,
you see, that's the attitude. You see what I'm saying, though?
Yeah.
That's New Mexico for a lot of things. And the people that try to do the right thing
are weighed down by everyone.
They are, but they'll defend it. That's what pisses me off. It's like they'll defend it. Well, at least the dog is going to get the help. No. Why did this problem become everyone else's problem? And then you basically defend the fact that everybody took care of the issue. It's like, well, the problem, in other words, the problem never gets fixed by the person who causes it. And the blame never gets put on the person who causes the issue.
That goes back to...
It gets pushed off like, oh, well, you know, they just couldn't whatever. It's like, no, why can't we put the blame where the blame needs to be? You were a screwed up pet owner that couldn't take care of your pet. So instead of you taking care of your pet and finding a good home for it, you put it out front of a Dunkin' Donuts and let everybody else deal with it.
Because singling out and shaming and causing the burden of a responsibility or shame, the burden of those two things, is more tremendous than any actual physical punishment.
Well, maybe they should, because then we wouldn't have to have some kind of freaking law where if your kid misses 6 days of school that you get arrested.
Honestly, everything you have described, as well as my rant, kind of lean back into the whole "it takes a village" mentality.
You know what? It doesn't take a village to raise a damn child. It takes parents to raise children.
Like actual parents.
Yes, like actual parenting, where you're like when your kid comes home from school with a test and they did poorly on it, and they go, "Look what the teacher gave me." And you got parents that call the teacher to say, "Did you cover all this material in class? Did you do this? Did you this?" Like, no, your kid earned that terrible score because they put no effort into it and you didn't help them study. That's the hard truth.
Yeah.
And, you know, it is what it is. When you watch TV, do you ever see like where parents are sitting down there going, you know, "Hey, you did a bad on that test. You need to get over it." You never see any real parenting on TV these days anymore. Now, I don't know. I don't watch the Disney Channel anymore, but I mean, have you seen anything like that here recently? No.
We see a mild version of it.
We see the other end of that where the student is going to buckle under the pressure and is like an A student all the time, but has to turn to drugs to cope with the problem.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay.
That was Michael J. Fox and Family Ties.
Oh.
Yeah, it's true. Yeah.
I'm trying to see this next article.
You just want to see what the dog looks like.
Oh, I did, and I'm so upset because Jackie is adorable, and I'm very glad she found a home.
I'm going to sneeze.
She's so cute.
Right in microphone.
Stop it.
Look at that poor dog.
I know.
I'm free. I'm having babies.
So wait, is Jackie?
Oh my god, that makes it even worse.
Wait, Jackie the dog is having babies?
I don't know. Somebody is having babies. It could be the previous owner, but it's more than likely Jackie.
Let me see.
So poor Jackie was just basically abandoned in front of Dunkin' Donuts, a pregnant dog, I guess. I'm free. I'm having babies. So not only can they not take care of the dog, they can't take care of the responsibilities that comes from not teaching your dog about abstinence or protection or birth control or whatever it takes for animals not to have babies these days.
Don't say that, because it actually gets kind of sad. The Santa Fe Animal Shelter said that they took her to an X-ray, and the dog, they saw something in its uterus but could not determine if it was the early signs of pregnancy or a uterine infection. That's kind of terrible. So at least Jackie is getting the health care that she needs right now. Poor Jackie. So sad. Man.
I don't know what to say about that.
That is just terrible.
Awful. Okay, I'm done.
Really? Already?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, gosh.
Hey, at least Jackie's got, she's safe, and she's being taken care of.
Well, maybe we can end it on that note.
Yeah.
So if you've been listening to GP Podcast, we've been talking about a lot of different things over the past 60-plus episodes. And one of the things that we do talk about is some of the stuff that we watch on television.
Yeah.
And by television, I don't mean cable, because we're not paying for cable, because we're not suckers. We stream. And one of the things I've been really happy with watching here, it seems to be getting better and better every episode, is the Grand Tour.
Yep.
Really enjoy that show. If you ever liked, what was the other one called? What was the old?
Top Gear.
Yeah. If you ever liked Top Gear, the guys that moved over and left Top Gear have moved over and created Grand Tour. They're in the second season, and to me, it's just every bit as good as the old Top Gear. Really enjoy it, so you should check it out. It's on Amazon Prime.
Yeah.
Comes out every Thursday. It's supposed to be Friday, but it's really Thursday. So, yeah. That's because England is about 8 hours ahead of us. So,
I mean,
like today,
I wonder if they have 52 weekends.
Well, yeah, they have the same. They probably have more holidays. They don't take vacations, they take holidays.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, anyway, back here. Just thought we'd kind of talk about that. But that's pretty much about all we're going to talk about with this podcast. We'll be back again for episode number 65, where we talk about more disappointing things about New Mexico.
True.
I'm sure.
Yeah.
And some other stuff. Maybe some happier stuff.
But, so. Yeah. Maybe some more stupider stuff.
Yeah. Maybe more. Yeah.
Yeah, more stupids.
More stupids.
Now, if you like, go ahead and give us a call and comment about this show or give us some feedback. You can reach us at 575-208-4025. You can also email us. Email us at cheapgeek.net@gmail.com. Just put, you know, Attention Greg or Omi or something. Music for this episode was provided by incompetech.com under the Creative Commons by Attribution 3.0 license. It was also provided by Autonautics under the Creative Commons Attribution License 4.0. Twin Musicom may have popped up. Did we play that? I don't know.
Sure. Anyways,
yeah, that's also a Creative Commons attribution.
Very nice.
Yep. Oh, and be sure to follow us on Instagram at CheapGeek Podcast on Instagram, and you can find me, The Ordinary Hiker, on Instagram. And again, join our Facebook group.
Yeah.
Yep. So that's it.
Cool. Sounds good. Anyway, this has been CheapGeek Podcast, episode number 64. So thank you very much for listening. We'll see you again here real soon. Any questions, comments, concerns, you can direct them to us or keep them to yourself.
Yep.
Choice is yours. Anyway, see you later. Take it easy. Bye-bye.
Bye.
I like peanut butter. I like peanut butter. Peanut butter. I like peanut butter. I like peanut butter. I like peanut butter. Peanut butter. I like peanut butter.